Hi, my name is Dr. Padilla. I'm a professor in computer science and psychology, and I've been a professor for over 5 years now. We are in the height of application season, and I've been getting some questions about the GRE, and I thought I would address them in this video because I know it can be confusing how things change over time. This video is specifically for the 2025 application season, so it will be up to date based on the things we know going on in the world and how competitive the application landscape is. So let's jump on in. Okay, so what is the GRE? It is a standardized test, usually required by universities in the United States in the past. So before the pandemic, the GRE was a required element in every graduate school application. The GRE stands for Graduate Research Examination, okay? And the reason that they had people include this examination in their application materials is because it was a way to evaluate everyone on the same metrics. The problem with looking at things like transcripts or letters of recommendation or your research statement, your personal statement, is that it's really hard to kind of equalize the playing field. For example, with transcripts, you might have had a really high grade in your relative classes, but you might have been at a very easy university, and someone at a harder university might have had lower scores, but overall they would be a stronger candidate. It is so hard to balance those things when you're looking at applications. So the GRE was an equal playing field. Everyone got the same tests that year. And the other thing that the GRE did is it gave you your percentile ranking for that particular year. Different cohorts of people ebb and flow in terms of their performance, so you knew in that year of the people who took the test what percentile you were in various metrics. And the various metrics included writing, quantitative skills, and vocabulary. So those are very important things for most all applications. But what has happened since the pandemic is that it was really infeasible for many departments to require people to take the GRE because it was dangerous to have people in a testing room. So starting during the pandemic, different universities stopped requiring the GRE. We are now in a situation where most US universities do not require the GRE. So why are we even talking about this? If you don't have to take it, why should you care about it at all? Well, I'm here to tell you that in 2025, we are in a whole new landscape of PhD applications. It is incredibly competitive. And one of the things you could consider doing to stand out is to consider taking the GRE. Now, why do I bring this up? As professors, what has happened is it's just incredibly hard to evaluate different applicants. And we're in a situation where each professor is going to be able to accept fewer and fewer applicants. What's going on in the US right now is that there's general cutting of funds for different positions and grants are getting cut. So we might have been in a situation in the past where someone could reasonably accept a student every other year. Now they might only get one student every 4 years. Or maybe a whole department with 20 people has two slots. So not only do you have to convince a particular advisor that they want to work with you in particular, but then that advisor has to go to their department and argue for you and advocate for you. So it's a whole different landscape, okay? So how does the GRE play into this? Well, the GRE is a standardized test, and if you happen to perform very well in the test, it is a very strong metric that you will be successful in school. It has actually always been a fairly strong metric for, you know, for complicated reasons, but it is another piece of evidence in your application. So let me give you a little historical perspective about the GRE and why it is a little bit controversial. Standardized tests had not been used historically, but it had originally been established to evaluate someone's success in very elite programs like Harvard. And originally, when they created the tests, they weren't exactly evaluating someone's proficiency in a particular topic. They were evaluating basically how successful they would be at Harvard, for example. And the reason that is a problem is because back in the day, many people were excluded from those educational opportunities. So it was actually just measuring, you know, did they fit the stereotypical standard of a Harvard student at that particular time. So there's a long history of that test being very exclusionary for individuals that are coming from different backgrounds who would be also successful in those programs, but they didn't meet the stereotypical look of a particular student at that Ivy League school. Full disclosure, I actually interned at the testing service that administers the GRE, which is really interesting. And I found it to be very, very fascinating how this test has evolved over time. What they have been able to do is look at the test and evaluate if any of the test items had been negatively impacting any particular group. And because they had such a large question bank, they were able just to fully remove those questions or modify them so they didn't negatively impact any any particular type of group. There still might be contentious reasons associated with a GRE, so you might be on one side or the other. But suffice to say, it is a standardized test that evaluates everyone on the same questions. So that is why it can be useful. Not necessarily a measure of your potential, but it's a measure of your ability to take tests. And that is a big part of being in graduate school, in part because graduate school is not just about, you know, learning the material. It's about, can you take tests? Can you jump through hoops? Can you check all of these different boxes? That's actually an important skill in going through graduate school. So the test is actually one pretty good measure of if you can do that. Now, I scored really low in the GRE. I did okay in the quantitative measure, but because I'm dyslexic, I scored in the very lower percentile of the written portion of it. So I'm not saying it was a measure of if I could be a professor or not, but it actually evaluated my abilities fairly well. And the other students I knew who took the test, it evaluated their abilities relative to mine fairly well. Okay, so all of this is to say, if you are a very good test taker, consider taking the GRE and including it in your application materials. It certainly won't hurt. It is extra. You don't need to do it. It does cost money, so if that's a consideration, don't take it. But if you're wanting to get an edge up on other people and you're really good at tests, this is one way to demonstrate this. It is quantitative evidence that you can do well in a standardized test, and that is actually useful information in graduate school. Now, that's not to say every professor will find it useful. It is not required, but that will actually pique their interest in you if you have a very high score. The way it works is you register for a time to take the test. You take the test, you get your results, I think almost immediately after, except for the writing portion of it. And then you can choose to have those test scores sent to different schools. So if you do really well in test, you can choose to send it. It doesn't get automatically sent. So you could take it and bomb and it's okay. But if you do really well in a test, it is something that might help you stand out. So as you're applying for PhD programs, I encourage you to think about your application material as a packet, a full packet that represents you. And that includes your letters of recommendation, your personal statements, your transcripts, and maybe the GRE if it helps reveal who you are as a candidate. Maybe it's revealing something wonderful that you want to show because you're great at test taking, include it. If it doesn't, don't include it. It's not necessary, but it really can supplement some of the additional information that you have in your packet. Hopefully you found this video helpful. If you did so, consider hitting the like button and subscribe for more content on academic success. I know academia can be tough, but you don't have to go through it alone. Keep learning, keep growing, and I'll catch you in the next one. Take care.